It all happened so fast, didn't it? On Thursday night, he's eating dinner with his disciples. In fact, I'm just trying to draw it down a little bit of a timeline to kind of remind myself of this. At sundown, he started the Passover, right? And they're having their Passover celebration on Thursday evening. Friday night would have been the main Passover celebration. They actually did it throughout that week. And there are all kinds of celebrations and things that were taking place. By 8 p.m., Judas has left the meal to go and betray Jesus. By 9 p.m., the disciples and Jesus have left for the Garden of Gethsemane, where they're going to go out and he's going to pray. For the next 3 hours, probably at least, Jesus is praying and really struggling through what is about to happen that day. And remember, the Jewish day began at sundown. So all this is taking place literally in one day. Sundown, Passover. The disciples out praying. By midnight, Judas has come with a mob, soldiers from the high priest, to arrest Jesus. By 1 a.m., they've arrived at Annas' house, giving time for the Sanhedrin to gather over at Caiaphas' house, and then they'll leave Annas' house and head to Caiaphas. And don't forget, even at Annas' house, some of the soldiers start to punch and beat on Jesus. By 1:30, they arrive at Caiaphas' house, maybe 2 a.m. at the latest. There at Caiaphas' house, they'll have this trial. In fact, if you go to Jerusalem, Caiaphas' house actually has a kind of like a hole in the ground in a room where you could only get in by being lowered or pulled out by a rope. And they actually believe that sometime during the night, after they had beat Jesus and while they were waiting to take him to Pilate the next morning, that they put him down into that hole, this little cell in the ground. Is it around 5 a.m. probably when that rooster crows? By 6 a.m. they've arrived at Pilate's house. 6:30 they head over to Herod's because Pilate says, oh, you're from Galilee, so he sends him to Herod. Probably by 7 a.m. he's back meeting with Pilate. By 7:30 they're whipping him, scourging him, flogging him horribly. By 8 a.m. Barabbas is released. Jesus is mocked by the soldiers. By 8:15, he's already out on the road and he can't carry the cross. Simon, the Cyrene, is grabbed and forced, compelled to carry the cross. By 9 a.m., Mark says Jesus is crucified. Or at least within that final hour, the third hour, which would be 9 a.m. for them. Mark 15, verse 16. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is the praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put on his clothes on him. And they led him out to crucify him. Don't forget, this is after Jesus has already been flogged. And for those of you who don't remember, the flogging meant that they had a stick like this with leather straps on it and pieces of bone and metal and glass at the end of that. And they would strike the back multiple times, tearing the flesh away, sometimes literally cutting open arteries and veins, killing the person maybe even right there. Insides would be ripped out of them as they would beat on this person. Eyes were torn out. I mean, this was just a grotesque, horrible, terrible kind of thing. And now, after the crowd is unwilling to release him, the crowd has called for his crucifixion. The crowd has found him guilty. Pilate's washed his hands. And Scripture simply says, and he was released to be crucified. And just before that now, as he's turned over to the soldiers, the Roman Praetorian Guard, they go into that courtyard there, and now they're going to have fun with him. Fun with him. I guess the crucifixion is too difficult for even the soldiers to bear, so they've got to make light of this torture. So they put one of their robes on him. They'll make a crown. And now they'll start to strike him on the head. They'll even bow down on the ground as they call him, "Hail, King of the Jews," as they pay homage to him. It's a grotesque sense of humor as they prepare him now, hitting him on the head again with a reed, trying to make him think, oh yeah, here's your staff, here, King of the Jews, here, let's honor you. And then they take him out to crucify him. There is some comfort in the middle of this horror, in the middle of few verses. Mark 15:21. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. And they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Simon of Cyrene, from actually a place that we today call Libya, probably a black man, an African, has come. He's a Jewish believer, so he's come to maybe this is his first visit ever to Jerusalem. But he's come with a desire to celebrate the Passover. He's just come down the hillside like they did throughout this week. The multitudes have been coming. Literally thousands upon thousands have come to Jerusalem. And here's Simon, and he's, as he's walking into Jerusalem, he doesn't know what's happening. Soldiers grab him, and if a Roman soldier orders you to do something, you did it or died. You might remember what Jesus even said as he was talking about this back in Matthew 5:41. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, who was he talking about? A Roman soldier. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Simon. Simon coming to celebrate the Passover. He's looking forward to maybe having the Passover meal that night. But now he will be unclean and unable to do it. As soon as he picks up that cross, he is doing something that's horrible. In fact, it's something that's considering even so degrading that the Roman soldiers wouldn't even do it. And now Simon, unclean, has to carry this cross. Simon will not be able to celebrate the Passover. Who knows how long he's waited to do it. But he will not be able to participate because he's carrying that cross of this condemned man, Jesus Christ. Mark gives us some interesting insight into Simon in just this real short phrase. He says, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Now, why would he name Alexander and Rufus? Except that the early church knew Alexander and Rufus. There's two passages of Scripture that may speak to this. The first one is Alexander in Acts 19. You might remember that Paul's at Ephesus in Acts 19, and the riot's been taking place, and we pick it up, the story, in verse 30. Paul wanted to appear before the crowd, but the disciples would not let him. Even some of the officials of the province, friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. The assembly was in confusion. Some were shouting one thing, some another. Most of the people did not even know why they were there. The Jews in the crowd pushed Alexander to the front, and they shouted instructions to him. He motioned for silence in order to make a defense before the people. That may be the very Alexander of one of these two brothers. And Rufus, Romans chapter 16, verse 13. Right at the end, as Paul is saying his greetings to the church and the people that really meant a lot to him, he says, "Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother, who has been a mother to me too." Why does he mention Alexander and Rufus? We think it's very possible that Simon the Cyrene, after carrying the cross for Jesus up to Calvary, will make his own commitment to Jesus Christ as well, so that his sons also follow Jesus. Simon meets Jesus. Can you imagine being Simon? The Bible doesn't tell us exactly what happened, but I cannot imagine Simon being grabbed by the Roman soldier, thrown down to the ground, put the cross on top of him, without him looking into the eyes of Jesus Christ. Simon will carry Jesus' cross to Golgotha, the place of the skull, to the place where Jesus will die. Simon will see this all firsthand. And Simon, I think, had to look in the eyes of Jesus. You remember what the centurion said about him? Surely, surely this was an innocent man. I think Simon looks at him, and it's that day that Simon makes his choice as well. To not just carry Jesus' cross, but what did Jesus say? Unless you deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. And Simon picks up his cross that day as well, and he chooses to follow Jesus. And then Mark says that they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And now, if you could start going one slide at a time as I do this, please. This is a picture of Golgotha, actually. You can't tell it. Underneath that table is a hole in the rock where they believe that the cross was placed. And now all this is over the spot that we would refer to as Golgotha. At that time, it would have been outside the city gates of Jerusalem. And in order for a person to be killed, they had to be killed outside the city gates. Prophecy even foretells that. Next slide, please. This is the Holy Sepulchre. This is where Jesus' body was placed in a cave. Can you tell it? Really kind of hard, isn't it? Well, they've built this building. This has actually just been renovated. This was in the renovation that just took place and just was completed like about a week or two ago. And so they've been trying to shore it all up in there. And next slide, please. This is the front entrance into that Holy Sepulchre. Actually, I didn't put the picture in here, but Debbie and Leslie are just off of this picture as I'm taking this one. This is the entrance going into the cave. And you can still see in there the place where they believe that Jesus' body was laid on a rock place. And that was covered with marble. One of the things they did in the renovation, they took the marble off. They've cleaned up the place, the rock where they believe Jesus' body was laid after he was crucified. And now they've cut a glass window in the marble so you can actually see the rock. And next slide, please. This is another site outside the city as well. What does that look like to anybody? Looks like a skull, doesn't it? You see the eyes there right in the middle? You see the whole circle for the nose? This is a site that some believe, in fact, it was back in the 1800s, I think, when they discovered this, and they said, you know, this looks like a skull. And what was discovered in the 1800s was that there's actually, next slide, please, there's actually a garden tomb. A garden tomb. Where was Jesus buried? You all should be saying, in a garden tomb. In a garden tomb. And there's some writing inside there and some things that make several people believe this could be the actual site rather than the other place. Whether it is or not, this is a site that's much more inspirational than the other one. You come here, you see that skull on the hillside. They actually have some crosses up above, and you can just imagine Jesus being crucified in a place like that, and for a place that actually looks like the skull. And then you go into this tomb here that's empty, which Jesus' tomb would be what? Empty, because he's not there. He's risen. He's alive. And so you go into this, and this is just a place, and the people come here, and they actually spend a lot of time in worship here, and there's places all around this where you can gather in groups as we did and just worship and just remember what Jesus Christ did on the cross and rising from the dead. Whether this is the spot or the one that they have historically said it is doesn't really matter to me. The fact is, Jesus died on a cross at a place called the Skull, Golgotha. The fact is, he was scourged and beaten before he was taken there. He was hung between two other prisoners. He was treated as a prisoner himself. The fact is that not only did he die that day without his bones being broken, which is also prophetic, he was pierced for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of the world, our sin, was placed upon him. He died and it was finished. Next week, we're going to look at what it meant for Jesus to be forsaken on that cross. So this week, we're just trying to understand, again, some of the facts of the crucifixion and what it meant for him to be insulted and the real pain that he bore there. Let's go on in Mark 15. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it, and they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. Does it affect any of the rest of you like it does me? Doesn't that sound almost anticlimactic? I mean, it sounds like, and they crucified him. Oh yeah, big deal. I mean, this is the most important event in all of human history. And it's just this simple little phrase, and they crucified him. As if it didn't matter, as if it's no big deal. And yet, each of the gospel writers treat this all kind of the same way. Both the flogging and the crucifixion are just stated in almost the simplest of terms. Matthew 27:35, when they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. We just read Mark 15, Luke 23, verse 33. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. John 19, there they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Judas, and Jesus in the middle. Mark says that they offered him wine mixed with myrrh. It was interesting, these vicious Romans, in all of their meanness, did allow the women to come and do something kind. And so the women were able to bring wine mixed with myrrh. It was meant to give them a little bit of a stupor. Didn't really take the pain away, just made them maybe forget it. They'll still die, and they'll still die a painful death. But this kind of takes a little bit of the edge off. Did it speed up the dying? It may have, much like sometimes the meds that we give when we try to simply make it easy for somebody to die. But Jesus says no. Why? Take a little bit of this to ease your pain. Some, Jesus. No. I think that the reason why it is he wanted to have a clear head as he makes the final choices as he dies there on that cross. He wants to experience every moment. He doesn't want anything taking it away from him. And so he rejects the wine. Prophecies are being fulfilled left and right. On Thursday of Easter week, we're going to do a trial of Jesus. It's really a trial of us. Do we have evidence that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead? Do you have personal evidence that Jesus is alive? And could you share that? Would you be willing to share that, to testify, if you will, to evidence that Jesus Christ is alive? Now, there's prophecies that clearly point to things. Isaiah 53, surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. I'm in verse 4. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted, but he was what? Pierced for our transgressions. It was prophesied that he would be pierced. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned on to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Psalm 22, we're going to look at this a couple of times probably in the coming weeks, but let's look at it again, verse 16. Dogs surround me. What did they consider the Romans to be? Not puppies. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. I can't help but thinking he's thinking of now, not just the Romans, but also about the spirit, the Sanhedrin and those who were religious but who were opposing him. Villains encircle me. They pierce my hands and my feet. How did they put him on the cross? They have to pierce his hands and his feet. All my bones are on display. And with all that's been done to him, He's hanging there naked, his bones coming out, showing through his skin. They said that when you whipped a person, you flogged them, you ripped the flesh off so you actually could see the bone. People stare and gloat over me. Remember that phrase, gloat over me. It's a nasty term, isn't it? They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garments. And they actually will take his outer robe, and that will be the piece that will not be torn because it's one piece, and the soldiers will cast lots. But there's one more prophecy, and I think it may be the most important one. It's the most profound one when you really stop and think about it. It's the first prophecy given about the Messiah. Do you know where it's found? You've got to go back to the book of Beginnings, to the third chapter, right after man and woman have fallen from sin, and God is punishing them, judging them, saying, okay, you're going to be taken out of the garden, and you're going to, because you've now desired to know good and evil, and you understand sin, and because of that, now you're going to be punished. And then he talks about Satan, and he says to Satan the serpent, and I will put, verse 15 of chapter 3, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. And what is happening to Jesus on the cross is his heel is being struck, but Satan is having his head destroyed. Mark goes on in verse 26, the written notice of the charge against him read, the King of the Jews. They crucified two rebels with him, one on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, and he was numbered with transgressors. Some of you will find a footnote, and your footnote doesn't have the words there for verse 28. It will simply say it was something similar to Luke 22, verse 37. And if you read there, it says, it is written, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And I tell you that this must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me is reaching its fulfillment. What did Isaiah say in chapter 53, verse 12? Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Jesus was treated in every way like a transgressor, wasn't he? I mean, you all know this. Common, well-known story. But they acted like he was wicked because that's what a transgressor was. A transgressor was somebody who was wicked. A transgressor was somebody who had broken the Mosaic law, completely gone against it. And the religious leaders were treating him like he was a lawless one who had broken that Mosaic law. He was as bad as the Gentiles in their view, which was another name for Gentiles, transgressors. And why did they treat him so poorly? Why so badly? Why so meanly? Because they believed that he had blasphemed against God. Or at least so they said in their reason for taking him to Pilate. They act very angry about that. But I sense it was more. They did not like Jesus. They did not like the truth he stood for. They did not like how guilty they felt when he spoke that truth. And they didn't want him around. Lawless? Well, he's treated like the lawless, but he is not lawless. He is without sin. Mark 15:29. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So you are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days? Come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe." And those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. The onlookers come up Come on, come down off there. You said you're going to rebuild the temple in 3 days. Come on down off the cross. But the insults began earlier, didn't they? Throughout his ministry, they've insulted him by the questions that they'll ask him. But if you just look at the last 24 hours, the insults began at Annas's house. Annas will have one of his soldiers strike him across the face because he responds with truth. It continued at Caiaphas's house when they try to lie about him, and none of the lies will work. And finally, you know, are you the Messiah, the Son of God? Yes, it is, as you say. After scourging him, the soldiers mock him. They actually bow down at Jesus. Hail, King of the Jews! They supposedly worship him. And now the people passing by, members of the Sanhedrin, and even, notice Mark says, even those next to him, found a strong quote from John MacArthur that I just got to read in its entirety. He's now speaking especially of the Sanhedrin and all of those who are mocking Jesus. Theirs is the epitome of blasphemy. It is the treatment of Jesus by the Jews inaugurated by the Sanhedrin, the Jewish Supreme Court, a religious court made up of the high priest and an equal number of scribes, the religious experts, elders, the wisest of the wise and chief priests, the very ones who were to intervene between men and God. It is that Sanhedrin that started the entire mocking abuse. It was they who first punched him, slapped him in the face, and spit in his face, mocked the idea that he could be the Son of God, the Messiah, the King. Theirs is the severest apostasy, for they have defected from Holy Scripture. They have defected from the revelation of the Old Testament, in which the details of Christ are prophesied so as to make the Christ who did appear recognizable to them, for he, in fact, fulfilled all that the prophets anticipated. They have therefore rejected their own holy scriptures, which they purport to uphold and to know. Theirs is a defection from God. Theirs is a defection from Scripture. Theirs is an apostasy from righteousness. Theirs is an unparalleled, unequaled blasphemy. Here you see sin at its apex. They are mocking the Son of God, sneering at God himself. Spitting scorn is blasted on the face of their Creator and their Redeemer and their Savior. Blasphemy cannot exceed this. It surprises me that the writers of the Gospels treat the crucifixion with such minor detail. Until when you look at this closely, you see that what they treat with detail is not the crucifixion, not the physical pain, but the emotional, spiritual pain that Jesus is dealing with. What hurts Jesus more? What do you think? The insults or the scourging? None of the Gospels focus on the torture. All they say, you know, and they flogged him. But they all focus on the insults. Matthew 27, verse 26, then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. No details about the pain. Our passage, Mark 15, wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Like he went down and had a McDonald's hamburger. I mean, he's like, what? Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, John 19, 1. The details of the physical pain are not what are focused on, but they all focus on the insults that attack his love. This is what breaks Jesus' heart. And the ultimate blow will come, as we talk about it next week, when Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus is hanging there on a cross, having been tortured and abused. And now he's experiencing the deepest pain of all. And yet he is going to die for the sin of those mocking him. Jesus, Lamb of God, John called him. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God, and he's doing it for everyone who's insulting him. Luke 22:20, in the same way after supper he took the cup saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood which is poured out for you. What is Jesus saying? I'm ready to pour out my blood as the Lamb of God for you, even though you will desert me, even though you will deny me, even though the world will insult me. John 10:11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Verse 15, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep who are mocking me. What did Jesus do for us? Romans 5 says it so well. Jesus took the curse that we deserved. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. Oh my. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. That means a cross. Jesus is cursed for us. 1 Timothy 2, 5-6, for there's one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed at the proper time. Jesus pays the price. He becomes the ransom. He's the one who's going to set us free while we're mocking him. Hebrews 2, 1-3 and verse 9. We must pay the most careful attention, Hebrews says, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. This is to Christians, friends. For since the message spoken through angels was binding, and every violation, disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? This salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard him. Now, verse 9. But we do see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while he's hanging on that cross. Now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. Everyone who was mocking, insulting, abusing him. You all know he had no sin, but he was crucified for our sins. 1 Peter 3:18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. And actually, in the chapter just before that, Peter also says, chapter 2, verse 22, he committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds we have been healed. And Titus 2:14 says, Jesus gave himself for us to redeem us, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God. As I am looking at this passage this week, it seems to me that our insults, our mocking, are more painful for Jesus than even the pain of flogging, the pain of being nailed to a cross, the asphyxiation, and his heart bursting. Because remember, Jesus dies as his heart bursts. And so my prayer this week, and I hope you'll make this yours, is I pray that I don't insult him. And think about that. How could we insult Jesus? We're Christ followers. We're not going to insult him, are we? But can't we insult him by the very way we worship or fail to worship? Can't we insult him when we falsely sit here and say, yes, we're putting God first, and yet we're not? When we say we're going to bow down in homage to him, but really we're just giving him lip service? Isn't that insulting to Jesus Christ? Can I insult him with my lack of faith? By not trusting him, by I'm going to be in control, I'm going to take charge of my life, I'm going to live it for me. Can I insult him by saying, no, God, I know better than you? Isn't that insulting to Jesus? And can I insult him by ignoring him when people who don't know him are around me? Aren't I insulting him? Aren't I ignoring him? If there's people that I know who don't know Jesus, and I say, I'm not going to talk about him. I may even fall into the same jokes or laugh at the same snickering. I'm actually giving into the same insulting comments and thoughts. And is that not insulting to Jesus? You ask it yourself. Do you insult Jesus? I dare say that none of us would walk in front of the cross. I know most of you pretty well. I don't think any of you would walk in front of the cross and sneer at Jesus. I don't think any of you would blatantly go up there and say, come on, bring yourself down from the cross if you really are the Messiah. I don't think any of you would fall into that. But if we had been there, could we not say we would have done that? But I'm really concerned about the fact and saddened by the fact that I think we all fall into times mocking Jesus, insulting him. And I need to apologize to you. It seems like for the last several weeks, this has been tough sermon material, hasn't it? It's like, wow, let's go to church so Pastor Bill can beat us up again. One more week of it. Well, frankly, there's only a couple more. Next week, God gets the beating, right? Father, why have you forsaken me? But I want us to think seriously about this. As we're moving into this Easter season, aren't we in danger of insulting the one that loves us most? And I would hope that you will pray about that and observe your own behaviors and your own actions this week. You have not just 2 weeks, but 3 weeks. 3 weeks to Easter. It's the best holiday of the year because it's the holy day of the year. Jesus Christ risen from the dead. And on that Sunday, we're going to talk about the fact that God wants to break out our barriers, remove the obstacles from life for us. That God really loves us so much, he died on that cross. We want to celebrate on Easter Sunday. But in the meantime, don't insult him with your lack of worship or your lack of faith or your lack of standing up for him. And you look at how you might do that. Maybe you can go away from here with a straight face today and say, thank God I don't do that, just Pastor Bill does. And then you pray for me so that I don't. But would you give it some careful thought? Examine yourself. Do you fall into some form of simple, unkind mocking of the Master, the Messiah, the Savior, who is dying and died for your sins? You see, he doesn't die again, but he surely can grieve when we mock him again. Did you catch that? Jesus died once for all. He's never going to die again. Thank you, Jesus. But his heart can still be broken. And it still is. When the very ones who should know him best insult him with their actions, their words, their behavior. Oh, Jesus, forgive us. Jesus, forgive us. The siren reminds us that somebody is in trouble, in danger, ill, maybe hurt in an accident. It could be somebody that's about to be arrested. There's all kinds of reasons why those sirens go. But it reminds us that we have a world that's in trouble. God, I thank you that you are present everywhere and you will be there for those who are in crisis right now. And I pray that there will be somebody who will be brave enough to share your love with whoever's in need. And I pray, Jesus, that you would help us to be brave enough to honor you in word and action, to honor you in the way that you deserve to be honored, because you took all of our sin for us on your shoulders and you died for that. You were hurt deeply to the core of your being. Your heart broke on that cross as you died for us. And all we can do is say an inadequate thank you. But we can also now live for you. So help us to learn from Simon. Help us to go not just allow your cross to take our sin, but help us to take up our cross and follow you. I pray, Jesus, that today every one of us will make a renewed commitment to serving you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you please take the tear off and let us know how to pray for you? There's some things that are going on in your lives that are very trying. I understand that. They're hard things, painful things. Those of you who read and pray over our prayer list, you know that some people are facing just some really tough stuff. Please give us the privilege to pray for you. And if you don't do it here, will you at least go to a life group where you'll allow some other people to pray for you by name in a personal way? And would you consider identifying who are those three people? You can pray for more. I'm not trying to limit you. Okay, but who are those three people that are in your life, somehow a part of your life? You see them at Goodwin's or post office, or they're your neighbor, your family member, but they're in your life that they need to know that Jesus died for them. Who are they? Will you share those names? Will you pray with faith for opportunities to love them towards Jesus? And will you give that as your offering today? And we're going to keep asking this, so I'm just warning you. It's going to come back. I'm going to keep asking you, are you praying for those three? And who are they? And if you don't know who they are, I have the confidence that if you ask Jesus, he will show you three. So ask him. And put it in the offering plate as your gift and your reminder. And keep praying for them. And Father, you know who they are.